So now we get to the fun part of lab. I'm going to first demonstrate the pressure cuff for you with some amusing interference and help from my sons. And then we'll take a look at some actual data. So we're going to demonstrate taking my blood pressure with a typical pressure cuff. This is an old school one. We have the gauge here that has the pressure. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and squeeze, and my son here is listening in, and he's going to tell us when you first hear the sound, right? And you're going to say what number you see when you first hear the sound, and you're going to keep listening until you stop hearing the sound.
All right.
Okay, what number did you start hearing the sound?
120.
And when did you stop hearing the sound?
In between the 40 and 20, like in that middle mark right there.
Okay. What I'm going to do, Ellen, is I'm going to increase the pressure, and you're not going to hear anything, and then I'm going to start letting the pressure out, and you're going to start to hear a clicking sound. You need to look at the number when you first hear the clicking sound. And then when the clicking sound goes away, you have to look at the number for that too. Okay, ready?
Mm-hmm.
See how the numbers are going up? Gauge is going up. Okay.
140.
Hold on. No, there's no sound yet. No sound.
Right there, in that middle one.
Mm-hmm.
When before I started, it was like, oh.
Mm-hmm. So it started at 140 and ended at 60?
Uh-huh. No, wait, no, it ended in like the middle.
Oh, 65.
It was like, it was like 63.
Oh, okay. So 140 is when you first heard the sound?
Yeah.
Thank you. Can you please? So although you're not able to hear the sounds of blood squirting through my arteries, that knocking sound that allows you to determine diastolic and systolic pressure, what you can see on the gauge is that when blood is turbulently flowing and pulsating through my arteries, you can actually see the gauge itself kind of bouncing a little bit. So in some ways, you can visually estimate what a person's blood pressure is by looking at the gauge. So now that I've demonstrated the pressure cuff for you, I'm going to actually collect the real data that we need for this lab. Now, my diastolic blood pressure number post-exercise is a little funky. It's identical to what it was before exercise, but I want to throw in an additional piece of information that you don't have. Yes, it's true that the diastolic numbers don't go up as much as the systolic numbers do after exercise, but I also want to point out that my return to resting heart rate was really rapid and actually occurred while my husband was taking my blood pressure. So if you saw me frantically trying to get that pressure cuff on and get set up, it was because I knew my heart rate was dropping rapidly. And in fact, by the time my husband was done taking my blood pressure, my heart rate had returned to the 60s. For this lab, you can use my data as shown in the video for cardiac output, or you can stick around and take a look at two other students' data from a previous semester, which will be shown on the screen momentarily. And if you keep that screen rolling, I'll show you some B-roll at the end. Thanks for watching. So what we're gonna do is...
Okay.
How many chambers do we have in our heart?
Oh, can you, is it an odd or even number?
You don't do... Do you know?
No, I'm gonna guess though.
Okay.
12.
What would you do with all those chambers in your heart? Why would you have 12?
To exist.
Oh my gosh, we have 4 chambers in our heart.
Close enough!
We have the valve. What would you call this?
A clock.
No.
A clock.
You wanna watch?
What'd you do?
Poked myself.
Why?
Because I'm drawing blood.
Do you have to do that? Does it hurt?
A little bit.